Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to Extended Hands of God Highway Ministries. It's Friday night. I'm Skip Etheridge, and I have the privilege of introducing evangelist, singer-songwriter, good friend and brother, Bill Schell. Brother Bill has been around the world sharing the gospel, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. He's committed his life to it, and what a blessing he has been to this ministry and to my life. He encourages me. I think I speak for everyone listening tonight that knows Bill. Before I turn it over to you, Brother Bill, we're going to open with a song. And this song, I love this song. I believe it's called The Blind Man Saw It All. After that song, Brother Bill, it's all yours.
Affairs. I heard a commotion a couple streets over and wondered what's happening there. A young man was running from in that direction and stopped just to catch his breath. I asked him to please tell me what was the hurry. He smiled up at me and he said, the crippled man, did he run past this way? He was rushing home to tell everyone what Jesus did today. And the mute man was telling myself and the deaf girl he's leaving to answer God's call. It's hard to believe, but if you don't trust me, blind man, he saw it all. Ask the blind man, he saw it all. My friend, if the troubles and burdens you carry are heavy and dragging you down, and you've tried everything you can possibly think of, there's no relief to be found. That very same Jesus that altered the future of the blind man, the deaf and the lame is still reaching out in your hour of trouble. One touch and you're never the same. And you'll be trying to catch the crippled man. Did he run past this way?
What a story given to us in song. I love it. I love it. I love it. I've heard that many times, and it just really tells a massive story. So, you know, what great words in that song. We appreciate that so very much. We are good to be with you tonight on Friday night and to get to share with you the joy of the Lord and what God is doing and what God is challenging us with. And I pray that tonight you hear the voice of God. I pray that you hear God speak and not me, because I don't have it. I'll just be real honest about it. If God doesn't speak, we are in trouble. I just can tell you now, because I cannot do it. It has to be entirely of God. And you know, I come tonight believing that God's going to speak. I seriously do. That's why I showed up, to be honest with you, because I believe that God is going to speak. And I pray that he speaks to every one of us. I need to hear his voice. And I dare say that everyone listening tonight can agree that you too need to hear the voice of God this night in your world, in your situation, in your life, in your family, in your home, in your work, wherever you're at. We just need the power of God to show up. And I believe that that's going to happen tonight. I seriously do. I'm going to talk to us tonight about a direction maybe that I haven't shared anything in the past. But that's okay. That's all right. That's exactly what that God has instructed us to do, what God has told us to do. Or I believe that's the direction that we're going, unless God changes our mind. And if he does, well, we'll do that very thing. I want to tell you something tonight that's an absolute fact. I have in front of me the most precious book that ever was. Pardon me. I may cough on you all night, and I sure don't want to do that, but I'll try to refrain as best I can. I have the most precious book in front of me that has ever been, and it's called the Bible. Doesn't matter which translation you've got. I'm not going to get into that tonight. Somebody asked me what's the best translation to use, and I told them the one that you'll read. But I'm not getting into the translation debate. I'm getting into the reality that this is God's word. This is the word that God has spoken to mankind. From the creation process until now, and through the prophecy of the return of Christ and what's going to happen at judgment. It is the divine word of God. It is filled with infallible truth. There's no lie in it. But I tell you what is in it. And this is what we want to talk about tonight. This wonderful book is really a book that is filled with mystery. And I have no doubt in my mind about that. I know that for sure. It is filled with mystery. We're going to talk about some of that tonight. Let's read. Read with me if you have your Bibles, or if some of you are driving. Don't read with me. If you're driving, listen to the word. I'll do my best to read it correctly. But in Mark's Gospel, chapter number 4, and verse number 11 and 12, we see that Jesus is speaking. And he said unto them, now he's talking to his disciples. Let's get the picture here. Jesus has been teaching in parables. And there is some question about what he is saying because of the parables that he's teaching. Sometimes they got it real clearly, and sometimes they had to wallow with it for a while before they could really understand. And that's kind of how we are as well. When we get into the Word of God, sometimes we understand clearly what it's saying to us, and sometimes we have to chew on it for a little while, as Brother Curtis says, to see exactly what it's saying to us. And that's what was going on with the disciples. And Jesus said unto them, unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables, that seeing they may see, and not perceive. And hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins should be forgiven them. Father, we thank you for this mystery that you have given to us that we call the Word of God. Some of it, Lord, we clearly understand. Some of it, Lord, we believe it, but we don't clearly understand it. But this mystery that you teach to us in this Word of God, we know that you are the key to our understanding, and you will reveal to us understanding that we need. We're counting on that. We're believing in that, and we're receiving that even tonight, I pray. Unlock this mystery to us and teach us tonight through this mysterious word that we give you thanks for. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I looked at this text, and I can validate this from several other places in the scripture, and may yet do that some tonight, but we can see that Jesus himself is identifying this book as a mysterious, it's a mysterious book. I looked up to see what mystery would be defined as, how would Webster give us a take on mystery. And some of the definition that I found regarding that word is this: it is defined as a happening which we cannot understand or explain. Now, we listened just a moment ago to that wonderful song. Did you hear what it was saying? He said he was telling me and the deaf man. And if you don't believe our part of the story, go ask the blind man, for he saw everything. Hey, the deaf can't hear and the blind can't see unless Jesus shows up. And then something happens. What happens? Well, it's a mystery. But the power of God has brought forth a change that we may not truly understand, and we most certainly can't explain it. Brother Curtis mentioned earlier tonight, as we were talking about a preacher friend that they have, that had been dealing with an issue, I believe he said it was MS, for a number of years. And the doctor declared that the MS was no longer there. Well, where did it go? What happened? I can't explain that. And you know, just a thought, my guess is that maybe the physician couldn't explain that either. Maybe didn't fully understand what had happened. But you know what I can tell you based upon the Word of God? I can tell you what happened. Jesus showed up. That makes the difference every time. And he begins to reveal the mystery. So where do we stand? What's going on in life? So with that thought in mind, thinking about the realities that the mystery is something we don't understand or that we can't explain, where does that leave us in the Word of God? I've had people to tell me, well, I don't read that word. I don't read that book because I can't understand it. I don't read that book because it just talks in circles and I can't get anything out of it. And it scares me. That's what they say. That's what they say. That's the mystery that's involved in that. Oh, my friend, let me tell you something. I've already said it. I will say it many times tonight. The key to understanding this mystery is Jesus Christ. and He in our life, and He begins to speak to us and reveal to us this wonderful, wonderful Word of God that sometimes is a mystery. I love the Word. As we will read something in the Word today, and it speaks something very definite to us. And we go back to the Word and read the same passage of Scripture a month later when we're going through some other circumstance in life, and the very same passage of Scripture will speak something entirely different to us than it did in the previous days. That's mysterious, isn't it? No, that's God revealing Himself through this mysterious book. It is given to us new understanding. The Lord Jesus Himself said that was going to happen. So it is going to happen. So what is mysterious about this book? I thought about this today. What could we look at in this wonderful book and declare, now that's pretty mysterious, something that we can't explain or that we don't really understand. And I thought about a few things that really come to my mind very quickly, and it's things that the world really likes to use against the Christians and against the church and against the Word of God. One of the things that I thought about is this issue of creation. Now, let me tell you something. There's lots and lots of debate today, as everybody knows, there always has been, about this issue of creation. There is all kinds of debate that's going on regarding that issue. There, in this world in which we live, there are some brilliant, brilliant minds. And some of them are dumb as a stump. But there are brilliant scientific minds that are out there that doesn't have a clue. And that's not double talk. That's reality. But they have made some wonderful scientific discoveries. They have came up with theories and they have ideas to figure things out. And they have revealed to us great wealth of information, and they have explained how things have worked and how they put things together and presented them to us to where they've absolutely made sense. We're not seeing a lot of that today. As we have seen in the past weeks, and I'm just going to say it, the past days, that this meeting that they've been having regarding the climate change and blaming the hurricanes upon climate change. Those scientific minds have tipped the scales in the opposite direction sometimes. But let me tell you something. These issues that's going on, even though they've solved many, many mysteries, they haven't solved the mystery. They've never came to agreement from the scientific community or even from the worldly community. They have never come close to figuring out this great mystery of the creation process. They have failed us every way they've turned. And creation, as far as their definition is, it still remains a mystery. And they teach that to the world. And so many of the world are gullible to receive. But you know what? To the believer, the gospel, the believer of the gospel, creation's mystery is revealed. It's not mysterious at all, because the Bible tells us that God created. We don't need to go any farther. We don't need to look any other direction into another reference book. We don't need to look at the studies that's been done. We don't need to follow the climate charts. We don't need to follow the water conditions. We don't need to follow the Big Bang theory. We need to follow follow the Word of God. And the Word of God says that God created, my friend, that settles the mystery. Ephesians, Paul began to write unto the church in chapter number 3 in verse number 9, and this is what he said, and to make all men see, who? All men. That's what he's saying. Make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. We don't have to wonder about that mystery, because it is solved, and the Word of God reveals it clearly to us. But to the world, that creation story is absolute foolishness. To the world, it's unbelievable. To the world, it could not have happened that way. But to the believer, we know it to be so, because it is in the Word of God, and it's been revealed to us through the Holy Spirit, and God has revealed to us that wonderful mystery. He's taken the mystery out of that, and we can understand it. So what else is there in there? Well, I thought about this, and I thought, it gets kind of personal, but what about God's unconditional love for man? Now, is that not a mystery? Now, think about this. Unconditional love for man, not hinged upon anything. Not attached to one's actions, not attached to one's belief, not attached to one's spoken word. God loved us while we were sinners. Unconditionally, He loved us because we was. That's a mystery. It really is a mystery. How could the Lord love us? Now, here's what we're gauging this upon. Here's what we're looking at. We are living in a society where the word love has become nothing but a cheapened adventure. And it's often very, very temporary. Oh, today, somebody loves you, but what about tomorrow? What about tomorrow? It changes pretty quickly. How many homes are split right down the middle on a daily basis because somehow or another love is no longer there? What's happened? It became temporary. See, we have this example that's been given to us, this unconditional love. We have got involved, and we have made adjustments to it, and we have tweaked it here and over here, and what is the truth is we have messed this thing up. Because love now is contingent upon what we say or what we do. You treat me right, and I will love you. You do for me what I want you to do, and I will love you. You talk kind unto me, and I will love you. But don't you do me wrong. When you do me wrong, I'm not going to love you anymore. That's what society says. But we look at the Word, and we see that God Himself gave us in this book of mystery the truth and the reality. He gave it not only through His spoken word, but through His own demonstration. He provides to us unconditional love. How does He do it? Because the simple fact is, we are unlovable. But He loves us anyway. Ephesians chapter 2. Verses 4 and 5 says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love, wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sin, has quickened us, or brought us to life. That's what that's saying. He has quickened us, or brought us to life. together with Christ while we were dead in sin, while we were wrapped in the rags of our sin, while we were living worldly, while we were living without Christ, while we were far from serving God, and He loved us anyway. How could it be? The world declares that this is absurd. The world declares there's absolutely nothing to this, that it's without understanding. But here's the fact. In and through Christ, love's mystery is revealed. For while we were yet sinners, He loved us. While we were afar off, He saw us just like we were and loved us anyway. That's a mystery. And the only means of understanding that is to accept the love of Jesus Christ. That's the only way. And then the mystery will be revealed. I went on, and I thought about one other thing, and I'm not going to preach very long. I promise you, I'm not going to quit real soon. But I thought about one more thing. I thought about the changing power of God. That's a mystery. That's a mystery. We read the story, and the song was so fitting for this tonight. It just worked so perfect. I'm so glad that she used that song. Brother Curtis used that song, and Shelley lined it up for us. And what a great job she did. Bless her heart. She does a great deal of help to me, and I just got to say thank you to Shelley for that. But it fits right here with this. The changing power of God. I read today in the book of Mark, in chapter number 5, and I read the comparison story to this in the book of Luke in chapter number 8. And it gives us the account of a man that is in great turmoil in life. The Bible says that his life was in absolute ruin. See, now let me stop right here just a minute, because I'm going to chase some rabbits right now. We are not the first ones that this has happened to, that our life has been in ruin. You and me, you and I, I'll get better English maybe, you and I, we are not the first ones that it happened to have life in absolute ruin. I looked as Jesus and his disciples had crossed upon the Sea of Galilee, and they had gone to the community of Gadara. And whenever they got out of the boat and they started into the community, they found a man there that his life was absolutely in ruins. Homeless, without everything, didn't have food, and the fact is, he didn't even have clothes. He was a wild man. Things had gotten so bad. He had gotten violent. His home was destroyed. He couldn't see his family, his wife, his children. They were separated because he wasn't fit to be around. They tried to contain him, put him in chains, put him in bonds. And he was so terribly tormented and disrupted in life that this wild man, the chains, couldn't even hold him. He was able to break the binds that they had him bound with. So vile, so wretched, wasn't fit to be around. until Jesus showed up. Jesus saw him as he was, ruined, outcast of society. Were it not for the love of God, he wouldn't have been worth saving. But for the love of God, oh, he was. And I'm glad he was, because it set the example for us. Jesus saw it. They had tried to change this man. They had bound him up. They had tried to work with him. They'd put clothes on him. They'd take him home to his family. And sure enough, he was still just as confused and messed up as he had ever been. He couldn't stay at home. He couldn't keep civil to anybody. And here he was in a mess, living outside in the graveyard because he had no place else to go. And you know what? I'm pretty much convinced he wasn't this way because he wanted to be that way. I can't help but wonder, and the Bible doesn't say this, but in my feeble brain, I wonder, what did he try to do to correct himself? What did he do? What did he do to try to fix his situation? But you know what? There still wasn't a change. He remained just like he was. No change was taking place. But this day, something happened. Jesus showed up. Jesus came walking up through the cemetery. Jesus came up to where the man was, into the tombs where he was, and saw him in that condition. And you know what? Jesus changed him, and he changed him instantly. Now that's a mystery. They had done everything they could do. They had worked with him, and nothing had helped. But when the people came out of town and they saw this man there in the congregation of the Lord, there he was listening as the Lord was teaching, sitting there in clothed and in his right mind, and participating with those that were there. They saw him in the congregation of the Lord, and they could not believe it. What had happened? Well, I'm going to tell you something. We're living in a society today that man has tried and tried and unsuccessfully tried to change man. And you know what's been proven? Man can't change man. Man can't do the work that needs to be done that is actually changing. You read so much and you hear so much about the 12-step program. But you know what? It only works to a point. And then man remains unchanged. How can an outcast be changed to be a part of the family of God? Now that's a mystery. But let me tell you something. That's who I am. That's who I am. Unfit. Unworthy. Unable to change myself. But when Jesus came to me, and when Jesus showed up in my life changed. And I called upon the name of the Lord. And as the word says, when I called upon the name of the Lord, he was faithful and come into my heart. He washed my sins away. He changed me just like he did the man that lived among the tombs. And when they looked at him and saw that he was unfit to be in the congregation of the Lord, they could have said the same about me. But when Jesus showed up, the mystery was revealed because he displayed his love. What's going on today? What's the mystery? The mystery is this. Churches today are filled with individuals that have been changed by the power of God. Some of them may have been the town alcoholic. Some of them may have been the wife beater or the husband beater that lived down the street. Some of them may have been the adulterer that lived down the street. The hardened sinner that lived down the street that everybody had given up on. They had been away in the institution we call the jail for 15 years, and now they're back. Unchanged. But now, Jesus has came. And now, they're not that same person. They're in the church. They're in the family of God. And they're displaying a change that has taken place. They're no longer a threat to anybody. The mystery of the gospel. How can that happen? How can it happen? Well, I'm going to tell you how it can happen. I'm going to answer that mystery. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. See, the mystery is revealed through the Word of God, through Jesus Christ. I thought about this today, and you know what? I can only hit a few of them tonight because it would take too long. I'd keep you tied up all night with this. What about the reality of death? Why, it's a mystery. It's a mystery. How can death not have a hold on us? It's a mystery. But it's answered because Jesus Christ lives, we live also. What about everlasting life? Death seems so real and is. But what about everlasting life? It's a mystery. I wrote a song a few weeks back and have sung it a few times. What will heaven be like? I really don't know what it's going to be like. But I know this. I'm going to like it. And I know this. It's going to go on for an eternity. And eternity is not just a long time. As Brother David Gibbs says, it's eternity. Everlasting life. It's a mystery, isn't it? So in closing tonight, the world doesn't understand why we depend upon this book. The world doesn't understand what God is able to do through it. And they make that pretty vocal sometimes. I remember not long back, it's been a while now because of the way things have been, but I witnessed to a young man, and he was working. I was out ministering on one of the cruise ships, and I have done quite a bit of that in the past, and hopefully we'll be able to get back to that sometime very, very soon. But I've worked on a lot of the cruise ships across the country, and I was one night about midnight, I was talking with one of the workers on the ship. We had ministered that evening, and was on the way to the room, and I'll never forget, this young man's name was Ron. He was from Indonesia, somewhere that direction. I believe he was from Indonesia, actually. But he and I was talking, and I was telling him about the Lord. And I was telling him about how good God was. And I was telling him that what God's got prepared for people that will trust him. And Ron looked at me and he says, "Do you really believe all that?" I said, "Yes, Ron, I do believe every bit of that." I said, "God's word declares that to me. And I've experienced the reality of Jesus coming into my life. And I believe every word of it." And his answer to me was this: "You know, I just don't know about that stuff. I just don't know about that stuff." I said, "Ron, you need to learn about that stuff. You need to learn about Jesus." I said, "Have you got a Bible?" He said, "No." He said, "I've never owned one." He said, "In fact, I've never seen one." And he said, "I don't read real well." So he said, "I think I would probably have trouble with that." And I said, "Ron, I'm going to find you a Bible." Now I said, "I can't find it out here on this ship, so I need an address where I can mail a Bible to you. I'm going to find a Bible that you can read." And whenever we came back home and got off the ship in Miami, Florida. And I started right outside of Miami, Florida, looking for a particular Bible that Ron could read. And finally, around Atlanta, Georgia, I found one, and the Lord said, "This is it. This is the one that I'm going to speak to that young man through." I bought that Bible, and I put it in an envelope, in a package, and I mailed to that young man on the ship that Bible. I've never seen him again. Probably never will. But see, I couldn't fix him. I couldn't change him. But I knew who could. I knew that Jesus Christ could. And I knew that if we did not have Jesus in the flesh, that we had Jesus in the Word. And the Word can do its work. We prayed. We asked God to bless that Word. And we put it in the mail to Ron. I don't know whatever happened to him. Probably this side of eternity, we'll never know. But you know what I'm counting on? Someday, meeting that young man on streets of gold, and he comes up and says, "The mystery was revealed to me through the Word. And what I didn't know, I do know now." See, the Word says this. Colossians 1, verse 26, it says, "Even the mystery which has been hid from the ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints." You and I that are washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, living, quickened unto life through Jesus Christ, the mystery is revealed. Thank God for the Word. It's real. It's life-changing. It's enduring. This night, the world will send you down a rabbit path. But I'm going to tell you, the Word of God standeth sure. Father, we thank you tonight for the Word. We thank you, Lord, for what you've shared with us, for what you've taught us. And Father, I pray that this Word would become more meaningful to us, become more revealing to us. May we understand more of it than we've ever understood before. May God, you hide it in our heart that we can share the hope that we have in Jesus Christ with those that need Jesus Christ. Help us to use the word, the mystery of the gospel, and reveal that mystery through your love to this world. Lord, if there's somebody tonight that's listening, that's never accepted you as a personal Savior, let this be the night that they give themselves to you. Let them pray this prayer with us. Repeat with us this prayer. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. I ask you to forgive me of my sin and come into my heart this night. I ask you, Lord, to be my Lord and Savior. You told me in your word you would come into my heart if I would invite you. Tonight, I repent of my sin and invite you into my heart. I praise you and thank you for forgiving my sin and for coming into my heart this night. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your kind attention and for letting me share with you tonight. God bless each of you.
Thank you for that message, Brother Bill. If anyone listening tonight asks Jesus into your heart, you just made the best decision of your life. But we don't want to mislead you. We want to make sure you understand. When you accept Jesus, when you ask him into your heart and ask for forgiveness of your sins, from that point forward, there has to be change. You can't say that prayer, ask Jesus into your heart, and turn around and go right back to doing the same stuff you were doing. Get into a good Bible-based church. If you don't have one, we can help you find one. Call somebody and let them know what Jesus has done for you tonight or today, whatever the case may be. Surround yourself with good, solid believers. We've got a Bible for you and some literature to help you in your new walk with the Lord. But maybe you didn't say the prayer, but you wished you had them. You've got some questions. You just want to talk with someone or pray with someone. Maybe you want to talk to Brother Bill personally. We can get you in touch with him. Just give us a call or a text at 816-729-6649. In either case, we'd love to hear from you. If you want to know more about us, just go to our website, extendedhandsofgod.org. All our contact information is there. We can get you on a mailing list, receive some CDs on a regular basis. They're free. We also have a mobile app. I encourage you to download. Just go to your app store on your iPhone or Android, search Extended Hands of God, download it. Totally free. All our sermons and testimonies, our schedule is updated daily, and all our messages on there are downloadable. So feel free to download them and share them with somebody else. We just want to thank you for joining us here at Extended Hands of God Highway Ministries tonight, and God bless.